John Richard Deacon was born on 19th of August 1951. He formed his first band, The Opposition, in 1965 at the age of 14. He played rhythm guitar, bought with the money he borrowed from one of the band members. He became the bassist after the original bassist was fired for not being of the same quality as the rest of the band. After being in the band for 4 years, Deacon played his final concert with the band, then called The Art, in August 69. Although he left his bass and amplifier at home, after less than an year in London, he decided he wanted to join a band. By this time, Queen had already been formed by Brian May, Freddie Mercury and Roger Taylor. And Deacon even saw them in October 1970. In early 71, he was introduced to Taylor and May by a friend who told him that they were in a band that had just lost its bassist. A couple of days later, he auditioned in a lecture room at Imperial College and became the last member to join Queen.
John Deacon, the last member to join Queen before the rocket took off. Coming into a group that already has three strong personalities takes a major feat of diplomacy, as well as musicianship.
I actually gave up playing music the first year I was at college, and then in the second year I was really missing it, so I got my equipment down to London, and I played with one group at my college. And then I heard about this group called Queen who were looking for a bass player.
So I came along in a way as a bit of an outsider at first, and it did take me quite a few years to sort of grow more into the group, you know, and find myself at, you know, at home really.
In the early days, I was very quiet because I felt I was like the new boy in the band, because they'd only been going for 6 months, but they had a few different bass players, and so I joined. And I used to keep very out of it, really, in a way. And the three of them used to argue like mad all the time. And I just used to, you know, and I said, "Come on, John, why don't you join in?" I said, "Oh, you know, I just didn't want to get involved, really, with arguments."
I think they encouraged him. The other guys wanted them all to have more of a stake in it, because after all, the songwriting, you know, there's all those extra royalties, and that's often an issue with rock and roll bands, and quite often a reason why some of them break up. So they wanted to make sure. I know Freddie, I mean, even as early as Queen 2, he'd be encouraging John to contribute. And I think John was just a little reticent. He was the last to join, and he was certainly the most shy.
John very quietly added his little bit. John was always sort of in the background, but he and Roger were quite often referred to as the powerhouse.
John Deacon was much quieter.
It's amazing to think that John was 19 when he joined the group. He was not arrogant, he was just very good.
After Queen went on to become a major success, John's natural business sense quickly elevated him to the position of Minister of Finance.
Just 3 years, we were with a company called Trident, right, who was management record company, the lot, and we were very badly handled. Well, not badly handled. No, we were
badly handled.
So basically, we got out of that one, right, by re-signing with a guy called John Reed. We signed with him for 3 years, right? Which basically comes up, which finishes in about September next year. And what we're looking at that point in time is basically to just look after ourselves.
Millions, basically, but I'm not sure how many.
Have you got a rough figure?
Not really. We could ask Jimmy.
John, you are a family man. Am I right in...?
Sort of correct, yes. Yes. I have one little boy, yes.
Yes, right. No. Do you find it difficult touring in the States and being away from family?
It can be a strain, yeah. I try and, you know, make the two work together, you know. It can be difficult, but I try and fit it in.
Well, he's a very happily married man, you know, with about four children.
How does he react to Daddy being a big star?
Well, I don't know, he can't talk yet.
How do you think he will react?
I don't know. I'll see then. He's just starting to talk now, actually, so...
John Deacon is the only member of Queen never to sing any lead vocals on any of their tracks. In live shows, Deacon did not receive his own microphone until the band's first headlining tour in support of their Sheer Heart Attack album. Despite the promising development, the main purpose of this was to play one note on the triangle in Killer Queen. Before this, he had sang backing vocals during Liar into Mercury's microphone.
It's the one thing I actually wish I could do, sing, because then that would make songwriting so much easier.
There had been occasions where his microphone was turned up at a point where his voice can be heard. One of them is this. Radio Gaga, Radio Goo Goo, Radio Gaga. All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Goo Goo, Radio Gaga. All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Gaga.
And then John, the strong, silent one, who would often be the one who, in the end, would influence the final decision the most.
But like John's,
there would suddenly be a silence in the room and everyone would sort of look over to Deacon and say, well, what do you think? Because what he said was always crucially important. He didn't say anything unless it was important.
Yeah.
You never knew quite what was coming next from John. I mean, we did find a note pinned to his guitar one day. It just said, gone to Bali. We were all in the studio in Germany. And we went to the airport and went to Bali. And we saw him about 2 weeks later.
He didn't write that many, but, you know, if you think about it, Another One Bites the Dust, You're My Best Friend, I Want to Break Free, big, big hits. And You're My Best Friend is still one of the most played tracks on American radio.
You're My Best Friend was a significant song as far as radio was concerned in the United States. I mean, I think that it was a kind of friendlier, more accessible side to some of the stuff Queen was doing.
And he would come in and we'd say, have you got anything, John? And he'd go, oh, well, I've got this. I don't know. You know, I don't know if it's any good, but we could try this. You know, very self-effacing. It was written on a Fender Rhodes. John played it. John played his own keyboards. And John, as far as I know, wrote the song about his lovely lady wife.
One of the things I always liked about Queen was that they were four individuals, all of whom brought something to the table, musically and in terms of songwriting, and that includes the bass player, John Deacon.
I started it off in England, actually. We had some time off, and I'd always wanted to do something a little bit more that was more sort of disco-y, which was very uncool at the time, you know, it wasn't the sort of thing, you know. But luckily, in a way, it came out quite heavily. But I started it off with actually a completely different set of lyrics. It was all about cowboys, which is why the American phrase, Another One Bites the Dust, came in, really. But then I thought that was very silly. I never even got to show that to the band, but I decided to change it before then. So I changed the lyrics altogether. And we recorded it in Munich, a lot of it, really, and Freddie helped out a little bit, you know, said, oh, like, we need something a little bit different there. But it was basically ultra simple, really. And in fact, we used, a drum loop, for the thing, because it was just so simple, and that's all I wanted all the way through, something just solid, really. And that was a way of doing it. Because it wasn't the sort of music Edward, we played at all, really. And I think the band was as surprised as I was that it became so successful.
I mean, funk wasn't really in the vocabulary.
John was pulling us strongly in that direction, a sort of funky direction. And John got Roger to play with tape all over his drums, which is exactly what Roger hated. Roger hated his drums being made to sound dead.
I didn't really want to get into dance music. It wasn't my thing.
Another one bites the dust. Freddie got deeply into it. Freddie sort of sang it until he bled, because he was so committed to making it sound the way John wanted it, which was like hardcore, I don't know what you would call it, but it's kind of more towards black music than white music.
Michael came to several shows, I think, at the Forum in LA, and he loved Freddie. And he kept saying, you guys, you've got to put that song out. And I wasn't particularly enamored with it, so I said, no, you're kidding, that's never a single.
Another One Bites the Dust. Another One Bites the Dust was never seen as a single. I mean, it barely made it onto the album.
It got on the radio, and it got heard by people that didn't even know who the band was.
Strangely enough, the record became huge because of the black audience. There's one particular station in New York picked it up, thinking that we were a black band, and played the hell out of it, and it became a huge hit.
I was like number one in 9 different charts. I mean, even in the country charts, you know, it's ridiculous.
And this thing just kept selling to around 3 million. It was in the Hot 100 for 31 weeks.
When an opponent would get knocked out in a boxing match, you'd hear Another One Bites the Dust used. It became an anthem of triumph.
It's still the biggest record we ever had.
I remember people pointing at the cars and saying, "You guys are bad." And what does that mean? That means you're good.
Then, you know, there's the pressure of His Majesty David being there, and everybody wanted to look suave and, you know, quick with ideas and stuff.
Dickie, of course, came up with this riff. Ding, 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 ding.
Ding, 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 ding,
ding.
He kept playing that over and over and over again.
And then we went for a pizza and he forgot it. It completely escaped his mind. We got back, and I remembered it.
And of course, we're used to playing together, and now we have this other guy there who's also inputting, inputting, inputting. The result is very good, but it was a difficult experience, I think. These people sort of pulling in different directions, in a sense.
Under pressure. Under pressure, David Bowie, the band, me. I don't think it mixed too well. Pressure.
Shame, actually. I thought it was fabulous. We could have done some incredible further things, actually.
Besides Under Pressure, Queen and David Bowie collaborated on another song. This time, it was a song wrote by John Deacon and Freddie Mercury called Cool Cat. David's contribution to this song is just backing vocals and a few lines of rap during the middle eight. All the instruments are played by Deacon, including the drums, guitars and synths. This is also the only Queen studio track in which Deacon uses the popping technique. The alternate take with Bowie's vocals still intact is widely available in various bootleg recordings, like this one.
Taking all the sunshine away.
there was something else. He did sort of like backing vocals on one of my songs that was on the album then. That's not Under Pressure, that's another one.
Right.
And when it came to being released, I mean, he didn't like what he did. And I was like, you know, asshole tells me right at the tail end when the thing is just about to come out. So anyway, that's, you know, artistic license. He just didn't like his voice right when it was about to come out. Mm-hmm. And I said, fine. I said, it's quite easy. All I do is erase his vocal and out it came. It wasn't like he didn't do a very in-depth vocal at all. It was just a background. It was just background vocals. So, I mean,
Do you think it was petty? I mean, do you think it was unnecessary?
Whatever. I think it was unnecessary, but I mean...
Are you not speaking to each other anymore?
Always speaking. It's just that we're in different parts of the world.
Interesting musically, I think, because John, of course, brought this very separate influence into the band. It turned out to be one of the great strengths, I think. You know, John really wasn't into heavy metal or kind of stuff that Roger and I were into, you know, Zeppelin or The Who or whatever. He was into funk stuff, and he really... at certain times in our history brought that influence back in very strongly. His track is very sort of sparse and funky, and it's got John playing this motif guitar. That's not me playing it, although I'm probably miming it in the video.
I think we got sidetracked by the enormous success of Another One Bites the Dust down a route that wasn't really us.
I mean, John's been writing quite a lot now, and he just writes in that one area which he likes, which is almost like a Tamla Motown or the sort of, and I love that because I love to sing on songs like that. So he's very different. I mean, you could never call his songs heavy.
A slow ballad, which is called One Year of Love, and that goes when he eventually decides to have another relationship with a woman again, because he vowed he never would again because it hurt him so much the first one. I'd just been, a bass player all my life, you know, with the band. It wouldn't be so satisfying to sit here now and sort of that would have been my input. I only consider that as part of what I do. I mean, actually writing songs, having and also being involved in the decision-making processes, you know, or arguments or whatever, is nice. You know, I mean, it really feels that you're part of our own destiny.
John, you're here, of course, to promote the new single, A Kind of Magic. You look kind of strange on that video.
Oh, well, I was dressed as a tramp, really. Yeah.
If somebody said, what album would John Deacon make? You go, I think he'd do a soundtrack album to a film about Biggles. And he did.
Queen. Introduce yourself to the audience. Okay. Who are you?
Hello, I am John Deacon, the bass player from Queen.
And I'm Roger Taylor, the drummer from Queen.
Perfect.
네.
그랜더 반론은 좀 더 배운 다음에 얘기를 하겠노라고 주변 친구들이 그렇게 얘기를 하더라고요.
네.
Japan was always great fun. They were always keen about members. They liked members in Japan. Ah, where is your member? Who is your favorite member? Have members arrived?
And their favourite member belonged to, or should I say, was this lovable long hair.
Hello, this is John Deacon from Queen here in Tokyo, Japan. And I'd just like to say thank you, everybody, for coming to see us. And we're just having a really nice time here.
John is just a regular guy. He said to me one day, he said, it's great. He said, you know, you join the band and sort of all goes all right and suddenly you get all this money. It's great. I said, yeah, good luck, mate.
Entonces, aquí estamos nuevamente y esta vez lo hacemos con John Deacon, bajista del grupo Queen. Después de tantos años en escena, o sea, ¿no siente la necesidad de apaciguarse un poco, o es que el rock and roll no le perdona la vida a nadie si vendió su alma al rock and roll?
He says that after so many years of performing on stage,
yes,
don't you feel a necessity to calm down? Or is it that you've given your soul to rock and roll?
I don't know. I don't know. Perhaps that is why we are here in Venezuela, because it is something new to do, a new challenge.
Dice que por, a lo mejor es por eso que están acá en Venezuela, porque es un nuevo desafío.
With Argentina and Brazil, right? With Brazil, right? Now we have been, the person who does our tours, soon Stevie Wonder is going to Brazil.
Dice que lo mismo ha pasado en Argentina y en Brasil, y después del concierto de ellos en Brasil, se ha conseguido que Stevie Wonder vaya a Brasil ahora.
Concierto
fabuloso para Brasil, ¿no?
So perhaps after we have been here, other names will come as well.
Entonces dice que a lo mejor después de su llegada a Venezuela vendrán otros conjuntos más acá, ¿no?
Bueno, esperamos verlo pronto también a ellos nuevamente, porque realmente su música sacude al mundo.
I hope to see you again here soon, because really your music shakes the world.
Oh, okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, okay, thank
John. You. Okay. Más angelical que tiene el grupo, pero además también la imagen firme de un músico excelente y de un hombre que conoce muy bien todos los aspectos del rock. John, welcome.
Oh, thank you very much.
John, ¿qué es más importante para Queen, el escenario o el estudio de grabaciones?
What is more important for Queen? Is it the where you tape or the show on live?
Well, they're both very important because they're two very different areas that we work in, and we take them both very seriously when we, you know, we spend a lot of time in the studio when we record an album, because that is very important, because, you know, when it is finished, everywhere, everybody around the world will hear it as it is, and you cannot change it anymore. And also, the stage show we take very seriously in a different way, because it's a live thing, and we try to make it as entertaining and as interesting as possible, you know. But it's a different thing, but they're both important.
Okay, él explica, Deacon, que para Queen las dos cosas son muy importantes. El estudio de grabaciones lo es fundamentalmente porque lo que sale de ese trabajo recorre todo el mundo. Y el escenario también lo es, nos decía John Deacon, porque fundamentalmente ellos están para entretener, y lo que desean es entretener muy bien sobre el escenario. Ahora, Deacon, John Deacon, ¿dónde está más feliz? ¿Sobre el escenario o en un estudio?
The studio, I think, but I quite enjoy that a lot. But I don't know, it varies, you know, when you've been in the studio for 2 months, 3 months, you think, oh, no more, I'd rather be on stage playing, you know. But then when you're at the end of a long tour, you think, oh, I think, you know, a slightly preference for the studio work, I think.
Él prefiere el estudio, pero es muy cansador el estudio también. Siente al trabajar, digamos, 3 meses o 4 meses, ya es suficiente para él. Él siente luego ganas de volver al stage y estar haciendo la actuación en vivo.
Queen termina de trabajar sobre Flash Gordon. ¿Cuál es el próximo trabajo en estudio de Queen? ¿Ya está proyectado?
Well, that is finished now. It's just finished the other weeks ago.
Eso ha terminado hace un par de semanas atrás.
Yeah, we just actually finished the LP. It's now ready, and it's just a case of being printed and that. After that, obviously, I think our next venture into the studio will be for our next album at some point, but we're not quite sure when to go in yet, because we've been working sort of very hard this year. We did a very long American tour, and then we had the, you know, after finishing the Game album, and then with the Flash Gordon project as well, and our tours at the moment. I don't think I've got a feeling we're not going to go to the studio till the summer of 1981, after we've been to Argentina.
Él siente que han trabajado mucho sobre Flash Gordon y que en este momento ellos quieren descansar un poquito, y luego de, digamos, el show de Argentina, ellos piensan empezar a trabajar. Les han demandado muchísimo trabajo el show The Game y el LP Flash Gordon. Les han demandado muchísimo trabajo, entonces se sienten un poco cansados, necesitando un poco de descanso. Y piensan después del recital de Argentina empezar nuevamente con el estudio y empezar a trabajar sobre un nuevo LP.
¿Qué podrías decirle a esa gente que va a ver a Queen sobre el escenario? A esa gente que por primera vez va a ver un supergrupo de rock, un show de supergrupo de rock. ¿Cómo lo definirías, el show de Queen?
Yes. Well, our intention, and we are definitely going to do it now, is to bring the same size of show that we have in Europe or in America.
Él está tratando de hacer el mismo tipo de show que están haciendo en América y en Europa.
Yes. So, I mean, you know, we will be spending quite a bit of money to do this because, you know, to get it from Europe to South America, it takes a lot of time because there's a lot of equipment,
Va a demandar mucho tiempo y mucho dinero para poder embarcar todo lo que significa el show en vivo para Queen.
Because we have heard that some people who tend to have toured South America, perhaps when they come and tour, they don't they do it sort of on the cheap, really. They do it, take a small show, and you know that's the way they do it. But our intention is to bring the full show.
Él explica que generalmente los grupos, para abaratar los costos, llevan, digamos, el equipo reducido, pero Queen tiene la intención de llevar su equipo a full para dar el show vivo que dan en Europa, en Estados Unidos, a full.
Dicen, aunque digan que los cuatro hacen todo en Queen, que este señor es el que se ocupa fundamentalmente de todo el aspecto financiero del grupo, de todo lo que ha hecho también en esta parte Queen, de mucho y de bueno. John Deacon.
Thank you.
John throws his bass guitar very angrily into the amp.
I think John was going through a difficult time on that tour. And I think it was sort of personal reasons mainly. And he was very volatile. And Madrid being one of them. And very thirsty. John had a little cocktail bar behind his amplifier. Complete cocktail bar, actually. Mainly vodka in it. And he had his roadie used to whip him up a few cocktails through the show, so by the end of the show he was flying,
So I remember, I don't think it was Wembley, I think it was somewhere in Spain, but there was a little argument broke out and John got quite iffy about something, and Freddie just turned around and said, well, I'm not going to be doing this for, this is probably the last time or whatever, and that was a bit of a jolt. I didn't know if that was a sort of instant response and an overreaction, or whether there was something else in his mind. I think now there was I think he already knew what he was going to be dealing with. The great thing about being on tour is that you can put all that stuff aside to a point, and just get on with the consuming business of touring, and it's great fun.
John, you enjoying yourself?
I thought you were going to get me. Yes. Yeah, I think it was Roger, actually, because at one point, I think he was listening to the song, it had this suggestion of like an express train. And then I think Freddie and I came up with the idea of having a train and calling it the Miracle Express. And it just went from there. So we said, they looked into the possibility of doing it, and it was possible, so we had a go.
We did the tour in 1986, which was a very big European tour. We were all absolutely exhausted and shattered, and basically we didn't want to really work together or see each other for a while. And then towards the end of that second year, we sort of met up, and Freddie suggested, I think it was Freddie, perhaps we'd try a little time in the studio. The main components is, in fact, it's the same four people. And, it's Roger, Brian, myself and Freddie. That's OK, come on.
We'll do the question again.
Yes. He's lying.
You can all come through.
And then we'll do it again when they're...
We fall out, we have patches where we don't want to see each other, or but we seem to be able to get over it. And, you know, if we take time off and people, you know, I mean, in a way now it's embarrassing to say, but it is 18 years since I first met the other three. I mean, they were actually formed together and had the band Queen, and I think they had one or two other bass players. But that is 18 years ago, which is a long, long time. But that, I think, is the secret in a way. The personality-wise, everybody knows each other, and we can actually understand each other.
On this album, it's the most, I think, we've ever done together in terms of music and lyrics, really, isn't it?
But apart from that, I have no plans at the moment. We've just spent a whole year in the studio. We're absolutely, I feel actually quite exhausted by it. I mean, it's been a long, hard slog, and even doing this interview is worse, but...
Come on, you've had a nice skiing holiday in between.
Oh, well, it was 5 days, 6 days. that was more exhausting than being in the studio. So at the moment, it's like take a break, going away for Easter with the family and then see what happens. But I have no plans at all after that.
John. Hello, I'm John Deacon from Queen, and I'm in Metropolis Studios in London, where the band Queen, which is Freddie, Roger, Brian and myself, has been spending a large part of 1990 recording a new album. The title is Innuendo.
Coming to shot, gentlemen.
All right.
So start on John.
Okay.
Exactly. Do it like that, yeah?
Yeah.
I think we're all throwing in different ideas. There's a lot more teamwork.
It's been difficult at times. We've had our good times and bad times, and where we've fallen out, and then we've made up.
I never thought I would still be playing in a band or, you know, recording at this age. You know, when you first join, you think perhaps 5 years, 10 years at the most, when you first start playing music.
After Freddie Mercury died, John suffered a serious depression. John played with Queen live for 3 more times at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert for AIDS awareness, in a charity concert with Roger Taylor in 1993, and at the opening of the Béjart Ballet in Paris on 17th of January 1997.
Another failed romance. the wings of butterfly. Fairy tears of yesterday grow and never die. I can fly.
In 1994, just as Queen were in the studio recording the Made in Heaven album, they decided to shoot a little video dedicated to the fans present at a fan club convention that same year. In here, we can see probably for the last time John Deacon on videotape talking to Queen fans all around the world.
Here we are, in the darkest Chiswick in 1994, trying to sort out the pieces of this supposed album, which will contain the last things that Freddie did, and various things really, which we're sorting out at the moment. So it feels quite strange, but we do still exist, and this is what we're doing.
Hello, it's John Deacon here. Greetings from here in London. As usual, I don't know what to say. So I'll dry up now.
But we're thinking about you guys out there.
Okay.
And that's why we're sending you this message, which is, if this ever comes out, please buy it.
Yeah. And have a good time. Hello, this is John Deacon.
Yes, hello, Roger. Yeah. We're in the studio again, and working away, and we're envying you. We hope you have a wonderful time at the convention, and we hope you enjoy this album when we eventually finish it. All the best.
He made the decision to retire from music, reappearing only briefly by joining his ex-bandmates in October 1997 for the recording of the final Queen song, No One But You, Only the Good Die Young. According to Sunday Times Rich List, Deacon is worth £65 million. Nowadays, he lives in Putney, in southwest London, with his wife Veronica. The two have six children.
Further than that, you would have to ask John. And I don't think he's probably in the mood to answer at this point.
And it's a shame that, you know, he really feels that he doesn't want to be part of the music business these days. I can see his point in some ways, but... you know, he just sort of doesn't really want to. He doesn't like meeting people a lot, and he has opted for the quiet life. Although he approves of what we do.